Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamu alaikum. Today we're going to discuss about the aerodynamic study. I'm today's presenter, Dr. Jamal Mustafa Khan, and my moderator is Dr. Abbas Jafri. So what are the objectives of my study today? What is aerodynamic study? Overview of the urinary tract. Indications of the aerodynamic study. What are the different components of the aerodynamics? Especially we're going to discuss about the setup, systrometry, and pressure flow studies. What is aerodynamic study? The study of storage and the voiding function, dysfunction of the lower urinary tract. It is a dynamic study because it is consistently in the changing and patient dependent in position, which consists of a number of tests that can be used to obtain functional information of the transport, storage and evacuation of the urine. Aerodynamics is the measurement of the relevant physiological parameters of the lower urinary tract to assess its function and dysfunction. In practical terms, aerodynamic study is most useful when history, physical examination, and simple tests are not sufficient to make an accurate diagnosis or institute treatment. So what are the indications of the basics of the aerodynamics? To identify or rule out the factors that are contributing to the lower urinary tract dysfunction, for example, urinary incontinence, and assess their relative importance to allow prediction of the possible consequences of the lower urinary tract for the upper urinary tract. To understand the reasons of failure for previous treatments. Recurrent incontinence in whom surgery is already planned, mixed urge and stress symptoms associated with voiding problems, patient with neurological disorders, and patient with mismatch between the signs and the symptoms. Outflow obstruction, patient with lower urinary tract symptom, at least uroflow study, and patient with the neurogenic bladder, all neurologically impaired patients with neurogenic bladder dysfunction. Before discussing the aerodynamic, let's discuss about the anatomy of the lower urinary tract. The urinary tract is composed of the kidneys, then ureter, and down there into the bladder, which is composed of, in the bladder, there's opening of the ureters at the ureteric orifice, while there are two types of sphincters acting in the bladder, internal and external sphincters, and then the urethra. So the urine expels out. Now the bladder. If we see on our this segment of the slide on the top right, the composition of the bladder mucosa is composed of uterine transitional epithelium, lamina propria, and then we have the submucosa, detrusor muscles, and outside layer is adventitia. First, we should have our knowledge about the maturation reflex, how the maturation reflex is controlled by the brain. The maturation reflex is controlled by the pons area of the brain. There are the two nuclei in the pons. First one is a median pontine nuclei, other one is a lateral pontine nuclei. The median pontine nuclei is usually associated with the reflex of the urine or the maturation reflex, while the lateral pontine nuclei have controlled the storage symptoms of the urine. The maturation reflex, it is a complete autonomic spinal reflex to get urine outside the body that is facilitated or inhibited by higher brain centers in adult. Number one, if you see the tension in the wall of the bladder rise above the threshold level, maturation involves two main steps. Now the second one, the nervous reflex, maturation reflex started at approximately 150 to 200 ml of urine volume. Now these are the different phases of the maturation. In the first phase, when the bladder is filling, the bladder mucosa or the bladder is relaxed, which is controlled by the pelvic neck, parasympathetic detrusor muscles controlling, these are relaxed. While the sphincter, it is controlled by the hypogastric, sympathetic and pudendal voluntary sphincteric nerves that are contracted, because we have to fill up the bladder. While in the first sensation, when the patient feel that he can urinate, the detrusor muscle is still relaxed, while the sphincter is contracted, because it has to be more contracted to control the urine that is getting into the bladder. While when there is normal desire to void, the detrusor muscle is contracted and the sphincter is relaxed. This is a flowchart of the maturation reflex. While the stimulus is occur when there is a distension of the bladder, stimulates stretch receptor in the bladder wall through the efferent nerves, fibers in the pelvic nerves, where the center is located in the sacral segment of the S2, S3 and S4. Efferent fibers comes from the parasympathetic fibers to the bladder to the detrusor muscle. While in response, what happened? Relaxation of the sphincters and the contraction of the bladder wall occurs. And in this sense, the urine expels out and it is controlled by the higher control in the pons, a facilitator area in the pontine region and inhibitory area in the midbrain. Now moving towards the abnormalities of the lower urinary tract, there are some functional abnormalities. First one is the storage dysfunction, which is a failure to properly store urine. Emptying dysfunction, failure to empty the bladder normally, and combined dysfunction of these both, which is failure to store and empty. Function abnormalities can be subdivided into the anatomic region of the lower urinary tract. First one is the bladder dysfunction, when it is overactive, causing failure to store, and underactive, causing failure to empty. Bladder outlet dysfunction, when occurs, there is overactive, causing failure to empty, while underactive, causing failure to store, and combined bladder and outlet dysfunction occurs. So moving on to urodynamics components, there are two types of components of the urodynamics study. Number one is a non-invasive urodynamics study, which constitutes of the uroflowmetry and post-residual volume. An invasive urodynamics study, this includes a cystometry, electromyography, pressure flow studies, video urodynamics, leak point pressure, and urethral pressure profile. So we're going to... That is before these two, because these we have to perform through that. While before that, we have should have a FAC, frequency volume chart, and the bowel diary.
Tell the history, and then you get an objective evidence of what the patient said. That's why we go for frequency volume charts. It's an objective evidence of 3 days or 5 days, a chart made by the patient himself, 24 hours, whatever is that sector. So it's an objective evidence of the previous complaints. So it is not included in that sector. It's a prerequisite of
urodynamic studies ke liye uroflowmeter hona zaruri nahi hai, na hi post void residual ke liye kisi bladder scan ya koi ultrasound machine ki zarurat hai. Isiliye aksar hum question raise karte hain, what is the simplest urodynamic machine? Just to see the act of voiding is a urodynamic study. आप पहले जमाने में मुरली साहब लोग खड़े होकर देखा करते थे कि यूरिन बना रहे हो, धार उधर तक जा रही है, इसका मतलब है कि तुम्हारा एनी स्टडी यूरोडायनेमिक स्टडी एनी स्टडी दैट गिव यू सम क्लू अबाउट द क्वांटिटी एंड अ फ्लो ऑफ द यूरिन और एनी एविडेंस अबाउट द लोअर ट्रैक इज अ पार्ट ऑफ यूरोडायनेमिक स्टडी. Just to weigh the nappies of a baby, one day baby का कैसे करोगे urodynamic study? सिर्फ उसका weight करने से आपको ये अंदाजा हो जाता है कि urine आ रहा है और कितना आ रहा है और कितनी देर पर आ रहा है. That is a urodynamic. एक antenatal studies में 5 महीने का एक बच्चा है, उसकी urodynamic कैसे करोगे? Scan रख दिया tummy के ऊपर, देखने के हर 45 minutes में bladder भरता और खाली होता है कि नहीं baby का. That is a urodynamic study. Anything that gives you some clue about the flow of movement of the urine or emptying or a filling of a bladder is a part of urodynamic study. As far as these modern things are concerned, you are 100% right. Or Abbas saab aap bilkul theek keh rahe ki ab humne isko divide kar liya hai, kuch ko as a part of the history, kuch ko as a part of examination, and kuch ko as a part of these sophisticated machine based things. लेकिन आपकी बात बिल्कुल ठीक है, वॉइडिंग डायरी इज एन इंपॉर्टेंट एस्पेक्ट ऑफ अ यूरोडायनेमिक स्टडी.
नॉन इनवेसिव यूरोडायनेमिक्स कंपोनेंट्स कंस्टिट्यूट ऑफ यूरोफ्लोमेट्री. यूरोफ्लोमेट्री इज अ नॉन इनवेसिव असेसमेंट ऑफ द फ्री फ्लो ऑफ यूरिन वॉइडेड पर यूनिट टाइम मेजर्ड इन मिलीमीटर्स पर सेकंड पोस्ट वॉइड रेसिडुअल वॉल्यूम वॉल्यूम ऑफ द यूरिन लेफ्ट इन द ब्लैडर एट द कंप्लीशन ऑफ द मैच्योरेशन. सो फर्स्ट वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस अबाउट द यूरोफ्लोमेट्री. Uroflowmetry is a simple, non-invasive diagnostic procedure that calculates the rate of urine expulsion as a function of time. It is performed by having a person urinate into a funnel connected to an electronic measuring instrument. The measuring device calculates the mass of urine produced during the interval from initiation until completion of the void. This information is converted into an XY plot with flow rate.
जो इसका सिंपल ये है कि जो वेट है यूरिन का वो उसको कन्वर्ट करता है वॉल्यूम में, और जिस रेट से चेंज ऑफ वेट हो रहा है उसको वो फ्लो या स्ट्रीम में
कन्वर्ट करें। It is commonly performed to determine if there is obstruction to normal urine flow. Some of the medical conditions that can alter the normal flow of urine are benign prostate hyperplasia, urinary blockage, cancer of the prostate or the bladder tumor, urinary incontinence, especially neurogenic bladder dysfunction, and frequent urinary tract infections. While in this picture there is a normal uroflow curve. The normal uroflow curve is a bell-shaped curve whose Qmax is achieved within the initial one-third of the total voiding volume. This is the maximum flow rate that the patient had expelled, and this is the voided volume in total. And this converted to time to maximum flow. The time taken by the patient to flow the urine at a maximum unit of time is calculated by the normal uroflow curve. There are some other patterns of the uroflow metric. When usually we see in our prostate clinic and other clinics, in the type A, there's a peak pattern of the hypervoider. Supervoid, it is also called as hypervoid, a peak curve, a high Qmax with a short voiding time, often seen in the patients with the bladder overactivity. In the picture C, if we go, there's a compressive obstruction. Compressive obstruction is Qmax is reached early in the flow and then a prolonged tail continues. In the picture D, if we see, this is a straining pattern, intermittent curve, patient is passing with the intermittency of the urine. If we go through the E, there's a constrictive obstruction, a box-shaped plateau curve is achieved, the prolonged voiding, and patient is consistently trying to void. So there are different types of flow meters. First one is the rotating disc flow meter. The voided volume is directed onto a rotating disc and the amount landing on the disc produces a proportionate increase in its inertia. The power required to keep the disc rotating at a constant rate is measured, so allowing the calculation of the flow rate of fluid landing on the disc. Electronic dipstick flow meter. A dipstick is mounted in a collecting chamber and as the urine accumulates, the electrical capacitance of the dipstick changes, allowing calculation of the rate of fluid accumulation and hence the flow rate. Third one is the gravimetric flow meter. The weight of the collected urine or hydrostatic pressure at base of the cylinder is measured. The change in weight or pressure allows calculation of the flow rate. There are different types of flow meters. Now the residual urine volume. Frequently, uroflowmetry is combined with the simple post-void residual volume. It integrates the activity of the bladder and the outlet during emptying. Can be measured directly by bladder catheterization or estimated by the ultrasound. An elevated post-void residual may represent obstruction, or more commonly there is a surrogate marker for dead tissue failure, which may be due to a number of causes. For example, chronic bladder outlet obstruction, neurogenic bladder or myogenic failure. An elevated post-residual volume is an indication for the pressure flow dynamics. In adults, a value less than 25 ml is considered normal, and post-void greater than 100 ml warrants a careful surveillance or a treatment. Now moving towards the invasive components of the urodynamic study. Now the first one is the cystometry. Cystometry is a dynamic measurement of the detrusor pressure during the continuous filling of the bladder. It is not only the method by which the pressure-volume relationship of the bladder is measured, but it is also an interactive process which permits examination of the motor and sensory function. It is used to assess the detrusor activity, sensation, capacity, compliance, and control of the maturation process. Cystometric studies are also called cystometrogram or CMG. Cystometric studies help to measure bladder capacity and function. Bladder problems including the overactive bladder, reduced bladder capacity, and incomplete emptying or an inability to empty the bladder completely can also occur with pregnancy. A cystometrogram should be performed in patients with relevant neurological condition like spinal cord injury, meningomycete, and other at risk of upper tract impairment with or without the symptoms. CMG should be performed at the initial assessment and at flow follow-up when appropriate. CMG will assess for compliance, reducer overactivity, reflexia, hyporeflexia to help guide the management. CMG provides diagnostic, therapeutic and prognostic information for patient in MMC and spinal cord injury. So what is the normal CMG? The capacity is usually between 350 to 600 milliliters. First desire to void between the 150 to 200 ml is considered at the normal. While constant at low pressure, that does not reach more than 6 to 10 centimeters of water above baseline at the end of the filling. It should be considered normal. A provocative measures, for example, cuff or fast fill ETC should not provoke a bladder contraction normally. Absence of systolic detrusor contractions, no leakage on cuffing, avoiding detrusor pressure rises of less than 70 centimeters of water with a peak flow rate of 15 or greater than 15 for a volume of more than 150 ml. And the residual urine, as we have discussed earlier, less than 1/3 of 50 ml. Bladder access by transurethral catheter or rarely by the percutaneous suprapubic tube. Filling medium, either gas, carbon dioxide or liquid like water, saline or contrast material at the body temperature. Ideally, filling should be performed in standing position and bladder filling either by diuresis or filling through a catheter. Filling, which is are of three types. Number first one is the physiological filling, which is up to 10 ml per minute. Medium, 10 to 100 ml per minute, or the fast is greater than 100 milliliter per minute. Children and patients with known bladder hyperactivity require slow fill rates. What is the reference point? Reference point is the superior edge of the pubic symphysis. We have to set up our transducer at the superior symphysis pubic level, and all the systems should be zeroed at atmospheric pressure. No air bubbles should be in the tube. This is a diagrammatic representation of the urodynamic systemetry. First in the picture, we have intravesical installation of either saline or the contrast. There's a catheter, two catheters are basically, one is in the bladder is placed, which is double lumen catheter, and another one is in the rectum, which is calculating the P abdominal. Through the bladder catheter, we will going to assess the P vesicle. And there's a water pump installation and flowmetry in the end when we allowed the patient to pass the urine. And these all are recorded into the computer suite that is placed over there, which has a program according to that and record all the three pressures over it. Position change mein nikal gaya sir. Ji sir, yes, done. Now the bladder catheter, this specialist catheter is usually 6 to 7 French or 8 French and made up of polyvinyl chloride or polyurethane. It has a multiple lumens for concurrent pressure monitoring and fluid infusion simultaneously. The catheter is introduced into the bladder with an aseptic technique using local anesthetic and lubricant gel. And the rectal catheter, this catheter is introduced into the rectum or vagina to measure the abdominal pressure. Single lumen perforated balloon rectal catheter with inserter. This is a working station of the system. Through stoma bhi sir place karke uske zariye bhi hum check karte hain pressure iska. Yes sir. Now the different components. First one is a transducer. The key component of the pressure measurement is a pressure transducer, which converts mechanical energy into the electrical signals. The transducer for the fluid filled system are external and adjusted to the height of the superior border of the symphysis pubis, the proximate anatomical level of the base of the bladder. There are three different types of the transducer. Number one is external charge fluid pressure catheters. ICS recommend the use of these catheters due to the easier use regard to the zero pressure and the reference height. The catheter mounted transducer, these are the mount on the end of the specialist catheter. They do not require fluid fill system and the external proximal end of the catheter is connected directly to the electronic recording system. एयर चार्ज प्रेशर सेंसेशन ट्रांसड्यूसर दीज आर दे आर द न्यूएस्ट कंसिस्टिंग ऑफ द रीयूजेबल कैथेटर विद अ टाइनी बैलून फिक्स्ड ऑन द डिस्टल एंड ऑफ द कैथेटर अकॉर्डिंग टू द न्यू गाइडलाइन ऑफ द ICS इंटरनेशनल कॉन्सिलर सोसाइटी Now they are preferably allowing for use of the air charged pressure transducer because they do not have a chance of any air bubble in it because they are not depending on the position of the patient. For example, this patient first when we have put a catheter in a standing position and when the patient is sitting, so there will be no change in the pressure while using the air charges. While when we use external charge fluid catheter pressure, because they contain the fluid, so we have to adjust them again and again when the patient position is changing. These are the transducers. Now, how the systemetry is performed and the procedure of the systemetry, the indication of performance urodynamic should be discussed with the patient. Before arranging the test along with the written informed leaflet, the patient should arrive with a comfortably full bladder on the day of procedure. Adequate counseling is necessary. These include the post systemetry, dysuria, hematuria, urinary tract infection, failure to catheterize, urinary retention, failure to reproduce symptoms, and the failure to arrive at urodynamic diagnosis. A uroflowmetry is the initial step followed by the measurement of post vasculature renal volume using transabdominal ultrasound or urinary catheter. During the urodynamic study, the pressure measurement is by using transducer and the bladder is filled with a pump. A computer screen displays live pressure traces and fluid volume. Both fluid-filled and air-charged urodynamic catheter exist. The fluid-filled system is primed with fluid to flush away any air from the lines. This ensures a continuous column of fluid between the patient and the transducer. By convention, the zero point of the transducer is leveled at the superior border of the patient's symphysis pubis and set to the atmospheric pressure. There's a short video up to the systemetry that we have discussed.
You are about to undergo a urodynamic study to investigate the function of your bladder. These tests will help evaluate the organs that store and pass urine, such as the bladder, urethra, and tissue that connects them. Some of the tests include uroflowmetry and systometry. Uroflowmetry is used to measure the rate of urine flow during urination. Systometry is used to check whether the bladder is emptying and filling properly. This animation shows how a typical urodynamic study is performed. Your doctor might begin with uroflowmetry. You will be asked to urinate on a special toilet in private. This toilet will measure the flow of your urine. Afterwards, an ultrasound of your bladder is made to see how well it emptied. If you have to undergo systometry as well, a catheter will be inserted into your urethra after receiving a local anesthetic. Then one more catheter is placed in your rectum. Both catheters measure the pressure in your bladder and your abdomen. Sensors on your abdomen monitor the activity of the pelvic muscles. Your doctor will fill your bladder with sterilized fluid using the catheter. You will be asked to cough or bear down to test your bladder reaction. Your doctor will check if there is any urine leakage and if you feel the need to urinate. When your bladder is full, you will be asked to urinate while the pressure is being measured. The catheters and sensors will be removed at the end of the systometry test. After the tests are done, your doctor will discuss the results with you and any further treatment.
Now the CMG parameters. Intravesical pressure is a total pressure within
time
ho gaya
na ab
sir yes sir
CMG
parameters this includes intravesical pressure the total pressure within the bladder Abdominal pressure is the pressure surrounding the bladder, currently estimated from rectal, vaginal, or extraperitoneal pressure or a bowel stoma. Natrosal pressure is component of the intravesical pressure created by forces on the bladder wall, both passive and actively. True natrosal pressure is calculated by the intravesical minus intra-abdominal pressure. Is P dead is equal to P vesical minus P abdominal. The physiological
subject in system physiology.
Subject.
Abdominal pressure from vesical pressure. And if vesical pressure is there.
Yes.
So ये simple system नहीं है subject.
Subjecting. Physiological filling rate is a filling rate is predicted maximum. Predicted maximum is equal to body weight in kg divided by 4 and expressed as a milliliter per minute. Non-physiological filling rate is a filling rate greater than predicted maximum. First sensation of the bladder filling, a volume at which patient first becomes aware of the bladder filling. First desire to avoid feeling during filling cystometry that would lead the patient to pass urine at the next convenient moment. And strong desire to void is a persistent desire to void without the fear of leakage. The next topic is bladder compliance.
Intravesical pressure, which is the total pressure within the bladder. Abdominal pressure, P abdomen. Pressure surrounding the bladder, currently estimated from rectal, vaginal or extraperitoneal pressure or a bowel stoma. Reducer pressure, P dead. Is component of the intravesical pressure created by forces on the bladder wall, both passively and actively. True reducer pressure is intravesical pressure minus or subtracted intra-abdominal pressure is P dead is equal to P vesical minus P abdominal. Physiological filling rate, a filling rate which is less than predicted maximum. Predicted maximum is equal to body weight in kg divided by 4 and expressed as milliliter per minute. Non-physiological filling rate, a filling rate greater than predicted maximum. First sensation of bladder filling is a volume at which the patient first becomes aware of bladder filling. First desire to void is a feeling during filling cystometry that would lead the patient to pass urine at the next convenient moment. Strong desire to void is a persistent desire to void without the fear of leakage. Bladder compliance. Bladder compliance is calculated by dividing the change in the bladder volume by the change in reducer pressure during that change in bladder volume. Compliance is expressed at milliliter centimeter of water. During bladder filling, the International Continence Society recommends that the following sensory landmarks be reported. First sensation of bladder filling, it is a volume at which the patient becomes aware of bladder filling. First desire to void is a feeling during filling cystometry that would lead the patient to pass urine at the next convenient moment. Strong desire to void is a persistent desire to void without the fear of leakage. Now compliance is, bladder compliance is a change of bladder volume divided by the change in detrusor pressure. P dead during filling cystometry. In non-neurogenic bladders, normal compliance is greater than 40 milliliter of centimeter of water, while low compliance is less than 30 milliliter of centimeter of water. Neurological for bladders, what is the compliance? The normal compliance is greater than 30 milliliter centimeter of water, and low compliance is less than 10 ml per centimeter of water. Now impaired compliance. Impaired compliance we will usually see in neurological condition. For example, patient with spinal cord injury and lesion, spina bifida, increased outlet resistance. For example, detrusor external sphincter dysenergia, DESD, long-term VO, bladder outlet obstruction from benign prostatic obstruction. Structural changes in case of radiation cystitis or the tuberculosis. Now the diagrammatic picture in which the impaired compliance is noted. As you see this last graph, which is P dead reaching up to the 45, we have already discussed that it should be not above the 40. So note that the rise in P vesicle and the P dead with the bladder filling. The P dead at the end of the filling is approximately 45 cm of water, which is potentially dangerous situation. In this case, the bladder was filled to a volume of 300 ml. So the compliance is 6.6 ml per centimeter of water. The arrow is the point at which the incontinence was demonstrated, which is the detrusor leak point pressure. What are the different measurements that we can carry out through cystometry is a bladder capacity. The cystometric capacity is a bladder volume at the end of the storage phase when the permission to void is given and the investigation moves into the voiding phase. Maximum cystometric capacity in patient with a normal sensation, this is the volume at which the patient feels that he can no longer delay the maturation due to strong desire to void. During cystometry, under the normal circumstances, the bladder should fill up to a capacity of at least 500 ml before there is a strong desire to void. Detrusor functions during the storage phase is a detrusor overactivity. It is a urodynamic observation characterized by the involuntary detrusor contractions of any amplitude during the filling phase, which may be spontaneous or provoked. It can be provoked by rapid filling, use of the cold or acidic filling medium, and hand wash. Now, the different type of detrusor overactivity. The intermittent detrusor overactivity, phasic, which occurs during filling, does not necessarily cause incontinence. Terminal detrusor overactivity, that is the detrusor overactivity occurring near maximum bladder capacity, usually results in incontinence. Compound detrusor overactivity, phasic DO, with an increase in detrusor and baseline detrusor pressure with each contraction during the filling. It occurs relative to underlying neurological disease. High and sustained detrusor overactivity involves a continuous detrusor contraction with detrusor pressure not returning to baseline. And post-maturation detrusor overactivity, in detrusor overactivity occurs after voiding, usually in the presence of detrusor or urethral instability. So as you can see in this picture, the phasic DO in the last, which is a P-DET line, and this is a filling phase, it shows the phasic DO detrusor overactivity that is occurring, and as the graph is moving in the terminal DO near maximum bladder capacity, there is a peak and it shows that there is an incontinence. If you see the, another line below that, which is not showing in this picture, it will show there is an incontinence, there is a leakage occurring. Leak point pressure. Two distinct types of leak point pressure can be measured in the incontinent patient. Abdominal leak point pressure and detrusor leak point pressure. So we will discuss this one by one. Abdominal leak point pressure is defined as the intravesical pressure at which urine leakage occurs as a result of increased P abdomen in the absence of detrusor contraction. Abdominal leak point pressure is a measure of sphincter strength or the ability of the sphincter to resist changes in the P abdominal. There is no normal abdominal leak point pressure because patient without stress incontinence will not leak at any physiological P abdomen. Abdominal leak point pressure, for example, if it is less than 60 cm of water, it is significant ISG. AL, abdominal leak point pressure, which is between 60 to 90 cm of water, equivocal or greater than 90 cm of water, is little or no ISG. Lower the ALPP, abdominal leak point pressure, weaker is the sphincter. The term abdominal leak point pressure has been used interchangeably with the Valsalva leak point pressure. An ALPP can be measured during the UDS testing by a voluntary Valsalva maneuver or cuff leak point pressure. In the same person, Valsalva voluntary maneuver tends to be significantly lower than the cuff leak point pressure. If the Valsalva leak point pressure is less than 60, it shows a significant ISD. Voluntary Valsalva maneuver is between the 60 to 90 cm water. It is equivocal, and Valsalva voluntary maneuver is greater than 90 cm water. There is no ISG. This is a graph representation of the abdominal leak point pressure, two components. First one is the Valsalva voluntary maneuver, while other one is the cuff leak point pressure. If you can see in the above picture, there is a cuff leak point pressure, and on our left side, this is a Valsalva voluntary leak point pressure. In the lower graph, the first line is electromyography. Other than we have the P vesicle, P abdominal, and P dead. In the P dead line is a deducer leak point pressure. We're going to discuss this afterwards, this picture. So the A picture is abdominal leak point pressure in a patient with stress urinary incontinence. Different in the cuff leak point pressure and Valsalva voluntary leak point pressure is notable. Deducer leak point pressure. It is defined as the lowest P dead at which urine leakage occurs in the absence of either a deducer contraction or P abdomen. A measure of the P dead in a patient with decreased bladder compliance. That deducer leak point pressure measures the bladder response to increase outlet resistance. The higher the resistance, the higher the deducer leak point pressure, which is potentially dangerous to the upper tract. We can carry out an example in that, because the deducer leak point pressure, it depends upon the resistance. As much as the higher the resistance, the higher the deducer leak point pressure. Deducer leak point pressure greater than 40 cm water is associated with the upper tract damage. In this picture, this is a deducer leak point pressure. As you can see, we have already discussed in the previous. In a patient with voiding dysfunction. Now the filling systematic demonstrating that deducer overactivity. This is a diagrammatic representation of the filling systematic. If you can see in the dark orange line, which is a P abdominal, is the abdominal pressure recorded by the rectal catheter. The dark blue line, P vesicle, is the intervesical pressure, which is recorded by the bladder catheter. And the pink line, the P dead, is subtracted deducer pressure, P vesicle minus P abdomen. The green line represents volume infused during the test and volume voided, V ura, while the orange line represents the urinary flow, Q ura. The black arrows demonstrate deducer overactivity. In the P dead line, if you can see in the pink line, which is of the P dead, that is the spike at the 2 times that there is a leakage or deducer overactivity has occurred, and the black arrowhead indicates associated incontinence. Now the next topic is pressure flow study. Simultaneous measurement of bladder pressure and flow rate throughout the maturation cycle. Best method of quantitatively analyzing voiding function. Access to bladder via transurethra or suprapubic 8FR or less catheter. Intra-abdominal pressure measured by balloon catheter in rectum or vagina. A man should void in standing position while woman seated on comfort. Indication for pressure flow studies includes to differentiate between the patient with a low Qmax secondary to obstruction from those secondary to poor contractility. Identify patient with normal flow rates but high pressure obstruction. Lower unit tract symptom in a patient with history of neurological disease. For example, cerebral artery aneurysm or Parkinson's. Lower unit tract with normal flow rates, Qmax greater than 50 cc per minute, a younger man with lower unit tract symptoms, and men whom lower unit tract symptoms, bladder instability rather than flow disorder, men with little endoscopic evidence of prostate occlusion. There is a diagrammatic representation of the outlet obstruction. The Abrams-Griffith number, now known as the bladder outlet obstruction index, it is the P-dead Qmax minus 2, which is usually the Qmax. If you can see in this picture, there are three areas, and the two lines dividing into these three areas in the last one. Or below there is an unobstructed pattern. In between these two lines there is equivocal, and above that there is obstruction or obstructed. If the obstructed, if the VOO is greater than 40 or greater, it will come in the obstructed pattern. Unobstructed, if the bladder outer obstruction is 20 or less. Equivocal, if the BOI is 20 or 40. Bladder contractility index, PCI, is a slope of Schaeffer's line known as the Schaeffer. Describe the formula for BCI. BCI is equal to PDET at maximum plus 5QMAX. Strong contractility is a BCI of 150. Normal contractility is BCI of 100 to 150. And weak contractility, which is BCI of less than 100. Electromyography. Electromyography use special sensors to measure the electrical activity of the muscles and nerves in and around the bladder and the sphincter. The sensors are placed on the skin near the urethra and rectum or on a urethral or rectal catheter. Muscle and nerve activity is recorded on a machine. The pattern of the nerve impulses show whether the messages sent to the bladder and sphincters are coordinated correctly. EMG measurement of striated sphincteric muscles of the perineum is done to evaluate the possible abnormalities of pelvic floor function. EMG activity is measured during both filling and emptying, and performed by electrodes placed in needle electrodes or near surface electrodes, the muscle to be measured. Electrophysiological testing is a sphincter EMG studies the bioelectrical potential generated in distal striated sphincter mechanism. Two different levels. Number one is a kinesiologic studies, which is examine sphincter activity during the bladder filling and voiding. A neurophysiological test examine the integrity of the innervation of the muscles. Overall, the most important information obtained from the sphincter EMG is whether there is a coordination or not between the external sphincter and the bladder. Normal voiding required external sphincter relaxation followed by the contraction of the detrusor. Failure of the sphincter to relax or stay completely relaxed during maturation is abnormal. Thus, normally EMG activity decreases before a voluntary bladder contraction. However, it is not abnormal for EMG activity to increase with an involuntary contraction as a part of the guarding reflex. Detrusor external sphincter dysenergy occurs when there is an involuntary increase external sphincter associated with detrusor overactivity and also with the voiding caused by neurological lesion in the suprasacral spinal cord. DESG can produce profound changes as the detrusor involuntary contracts against a relatively closed sphincter, cause impaired bladder compliance over the time. DESG may be considered a urodynamic risk factor for upper tract deterioration. True DESG only occurs when there is a known urological lesion above the sacral maturation center. The kinesiologic study. Signal may be recorded by surface electrode or by hooked wire electrodes into the periurethral muscle. Before filling, patient asked to demonstrate the violational control of sphincter. Bulbo-Cavendish reflex is tested. EMG activity gradually increases during filling systemetry, recruitment, and then ceases and remains so for the time of voiding. Once the bladder is empty, sphincter EMG activity resumes. Failure of the sphincter to relax or stay completely relaxed during maturation is abnormal. In patient with neurological disease, this is called the detrusor sphincter dysenergia. In the absence of neurological disease, it is called the pelvic floor hyperactivity or dysfunctional voiding. Kinesiologic studies do not diagnose neuropathy but may characterize effects of it. Important role in identification of normal sphincter activity in patients with neurological bladder dysfunction and in those with voiding dysfunction of behavioral origin. This is a graph which shows the EMG activity. As you can see in the first line, there is an EMG or Q flow. EMG for neurogenic bladder is performed with EMG with systematogram along with the pressure flow studies in patients with relevant neurological diseases at risk for neurogenic bladder or in patients with other neurological diseases with elevated post-voiding residual or urinary symptoms. EMG measures signals from external urethral sphincter, external anal sphincter and pelvic floor muscles to determine if perineal contractions are coordinated or uncoordinated with the trusor contractions. EMG is helpful in assessing for DSD, involuntary contraction of the external sphincter during the trusor contraction, and EMG with fluoroscopy, CMG, and pressure flow studies to obtain the most accurate diagnosis. Now the last topic is urethral pressure flowmetry. As you can see this in picture, there's a catheter that is placed in the bladder, and when we have to perform the urethral pressure flowmetry, we have to pull back this catheter. What does this catheter do? It shows the pressure that is required to open the urethra. It has a puller at its end, a catheter. Urethral pressure profile. A small catheter with a lateral aperture is used through which fluid is continuously infused. Simultaneously, bladder and urethral pressure is measured as a catheter is slowly withdrawn along the course of the urethra. Urethral pressure is defined as a fluid pressure noted to just open a closed urethra. This is a chart of the urethral pressure flowmetry. So the first one is the maximum urethral pressure is the highest pressure measured along the urethral pressure profile. It is the total pressure which is along the length of the urethra. Maximum urethral closure pressure is the maximum difference between the urethral pressure and the intravesical pressure. And the functional profile length is the length of the urethra along which the urethral pressure exceeds intravesical in women. So this concludes the topic of discussion. Now we have a short video about the systemetry and the latest thing that we have.
What is urodynamics?
Urodynamics, or UDS, is a procedure that is used to assess the function of your lower urinary tract, which includes the bladder. Your healthcare provider has spent some time going over your symptoms and complaints. Sometimes this information doesn't clearly spell out the problem. UDS helps identify specific problems and helps with tailoring the therapy.
How long does the procedure take?
The length of urodynamics is variable based on patient-specific requirements. The standard procedure is approximately 60 minutes. Sometimes patients require x-rays during the procedure, which can lengthen the test time. You should plan for approximately 90 to 120 minutes in the office.
What are the steps of the procedure?
You will enter the urodynamic suite in the office. You will then be asked to urinate. A small catheter will be placed into the bladder to drain out the leftover urine, which will show how well your bladder emptied. This catheter will then be used to measure the pressure inside your bladder and its response to being filled. Another catheter, the size of a spaghetti noodle, will then be placed into the rectum or vagina to measure the abdominal pressure. Patches will also be placed in your pelvic area to measure the electrical activity of certain muscles. Your bladder will then be filled with saline or contrast, and you will be asked three questions as it is filled. 1. When do you first have a sensation of filling? 2. When would you start looking for a bathroom? 3. When would you urgently require a bathroom, about to have an accident? At the end of the procedure, you will urinate and additional data will be collected.
When will I find out about the results of the procedure?
Sometimes the preliminary findings will be discussed at the time of the test. However, most of the review will be done at a later visit.
Are there any risks associated with urodynamics?
Urodynamics is a very safe procedure. However, as with all procedures, there are some minor risks. There may be some discomfort from the catheters. However, after the procedure, most patients state that it wasn't as bad as they thought it would be. Some patients may see blood in their urine or experience some burning after the procedure. This is normal and should resolve within 24 hours. Rarely, some patients may develop a urinary tract infection after the procedure. If you develop any of the following, please call the office. A persistent burning sensation when you urinate. Increased frequency of urination. Increased urgency of urination. An unusual odor or cloudiness to your urine. If you have any questions or would like to reschedule your appointment for any reason, please contact the urology office and we would be happy to assist you.
Thank you.